Hey there, I'm Lisa Harless with Regions Bank. I've been an entertainment banker for 35 years, and I have a very special guest with me, Terry McBride.
Oh, hey, Lisa.
Introduce yourself.
Well, I'm Terry McBride. I used to be somebody.
Always somebody.
I've been around for about 35 years, which I think I must have met you right after you got in the business, because we have literally known each other for that long now. It's hard to believe.
So you have been in this business for over 30 years,
wow,
as I have been. How have you kept your creative edge? I mean, what kind of things do you do to stay fresh and relevant to today's market?
Well, it's been an interesting journey for me. You know, I was a writer who got a record deal. Then I was an artist. Then I wasn't. Then I was back to being a writer. And it's just been the changes of the business have kind of kept me going.
And you started out in a band, McBride and the Ride. And tell us what instrument you as the lead singer play.
Yeah, I'm the bass player.
Which is a little different for
especially
the lead singer.
Especially 30 years ago when I came to town, people were not sure if that was the proper thing to be doing. They were kind of shocked. I mean, you know, in my mind, Paul McCartney is a bass
absolutely
player. Sting does a pretty good job of it.
Nails it.
It was just what I did.
But also, you're a backing musician and vocalist for a duo that took the world by storm, and tell us about that experience.
And one of the early cuts that I got as a songwriter was Brooks and Dunn. They cut one of my songs called I Am That Man, which became a big hit. And Ronnie reached out and said, man, I've always been a fan of your music, and why don't you come over to the house and let's visit, you know? And so I did. And through that, we just hit it off.
So I'm curious about your creative process when this idea comes. Where do you get ideas as a songwriter?
Honestly, through conversations sometimes. Somebody will say the strangest or flip something in a way they didn't even mean to say it, and it can come out in a way that is refreshing or different, you know? And I'm always open to that and listening and hoping, you know? Or it's sitting with the guitar and possibly maybe a melody will come that will inspire possibly, hopefully, a lyric.
Right.
So it comes in different ways and in different waves, you know.
So now here you are, an independent artist, a professional songwriter. What have you done during the pandemic to keep your creative chops, to connect with your fans? What's the last, say, 15 months look like for Terry McBride?
Well, that's a good question because it has totally changed, you know, not only for me, but for everybody.
Sure.
I went from a touring, you know, we did about 50 dates prior to COVID, so we were hoping to do even more, possibly, but that ended quickly and done. So I had to pivot, to say the least.
Pivot is a word I've used a lot in recent months.
To say the least,
yes.
That's what I did, and had to figure out what am I going to do for the fans I do have, and we had to start planning and thinking. Fortunately for me, I had just finished an album, my first solo album ever, and I had that in my back pocket, and so I thought, even though it is COVID, we're not touring, it gave me something to work towards.
Right, a reason to connect with the fans.
It did.
And the media.
It was a project, you know,
right.
And so I had that. So
go ahead and say the name of this fabulous new project.
The album is called Rebels and Angels. It was a great project, so I had that to talk about and promote and release.
Another thing some of our songwriter clients have done during the pandemic is they have had virtual concerts for companies. And, you know, I have had people say, how can we help the musicians and the songwriters
right
during this pandemic?
You know, for me personally, you do miss the audience, but I did do a Zoom fan sort of appreciation show.
Nice.
And when I did it, I got completely overcome with emotion that I wasn't expecting. I actually had to stop and kind of regain my composure a little bit because I saw all these, I'm kind of getting a little emotional now, I don't even know why, but I saw all these faces, some of them I know.
Yes.
And some of the family, but lots of fans.
Fans that have been supporting you for 30
there they
years,
were,
buying every
smiling
record,
and
every
cheering me on. It was just like, wow, it was emotional. And I didn't know you could even experience that through a visual situation like that. I wasn't even in person, but I still got completely overcome by just, a lot of it was just joy, seeing people so happy. And it was wonderful
seeing
experience.
Faces, even if they weren't in person, they were on
the
screen.
Oh, it was fantastic.
Well, you're talking about things that you've been doing creatively during the pandemic.
Right.
Those things take money.
Right.
And the pandemic has certainly affected resources for the music industry clients. I hear about some of our songwriters who own some copyrights that maybe they've got an injection of cash during the pandemic from the sale of some assets. I mean, is that something that's been part of your world this past year?
Well, you bet. It's been part of my world ever since I started having some success. There's always an option to sell some catalog if you have recouped and you own your portion of your publishing.
That's good.
And I've tracked down some finances and some income over the years that has been owed that just got overlooked for whatever reason. But it's my business and I need to know it, you know? And so there has always...
That's a big point of wisdom there. To even though you're focusing on your creative talents and your music projects and writing, you are keeping the eye toward the finances.
Right.
Because you've still got to cover the monthly expenses. So.
You bet. And so getting back to your question earlier, all these years later, I've always held on to my publishing. I've never sold anything and started getting some interest and some offers. And most of them were lower than I just felt I deserved, mm-hmm. based on what the earnings were.
Right.
I could tell, I knew my catalog better than most people who were even trying to help me sell it. You know, I knew and I could see we were having some spikes. Things were changing. I had a big pop song, which was a fluke in Europe, a massive EDM hit, which had, it has almost 1 billion streams, the one song.
Amazing.
Yeah, it was amazing. Started off as a country song here by Easton Corbin and was heard by a young EDM artist in Belgium. And he recorded his version of it. The next thing you know, we have hundreds of millions of streams and downloads, and it's coming
from... I'm seeing dollar signs.
Yeah.
As your financial advisor, I see money.
It's the biggest song I've ever had, and I've had
the name of that song?
It's called Are You With Me?
All right.
And that artist is called Lost Frequencies. He's a young EDM artist, hugely popular because of that song. But he's gone on. He just signed with Sony this week, I saw. And he just released an EP during the pandemic, and I wrote a song for him, me and Tommy Lee James. We have a song on there that we wrote with him, and that's my second cut with him, a guy I've never met.
So the market value of these copyrights or songs is determined by they look at the historical earnings of songs, and then a multiple is applied.
That's right.
And then you come up with a value, and so finally a company came to you with an amount that you're like, yep. These songs or this ownership of these particular songs is worth this, I will sell. Is
that exactly right? It came at a time where I thought I could use that money and reinvest some in myself with this project that was coming up. And then finally got an offer.
It gave you breathing room.
It did. That helped a lot.
Well, you sound optimistic about the future. You've got tour dates on the books. You're writing. I'm just so excited that I've gotten to work with you for over 30 years and to see your path and how you keep reinventing yourself and staying relevant and creating. And I'm just so proud to know you.
You know, you love songwriters. You love this.
Yes. I love your creative process.
You love it, and it shows. And you share that whenever something corporate comes along or something you think I might fit well into, you're the first to reach out, and that's great.
Thank you guys so much for tuning in. It's been a pleasure. And thank you, Terry McBride.
Thank you, Lisa.